Is this on? Can people hear me?
Yes.
Is that okay? Talking about South Australians, did anyone notice on Tony Townsend's talk that the river was completely left off in South Australia? Yeah. It happens all the time. The Murray stops at Mildura. I think it's a New South Wales thing. Right. Do I have a clicker? Excellent. All right. First of all, my name's on this talk, but you can only undertake projects like this with really large collaborations. So I've got to say a big thank you to the guys in New South Wales Fisheries, to the Arthur Eiler Institute in Victoria, and some of the ongoing work that we've also got people from Griffith University and Charles Sturt University. So big groups of people. Before diving into the science, and I am going to talk about science and not try and crack too many jokes because I couldn't follow up that group before, I just want to give a bit of context, I suppose, to look at the region that I'm talking about and why we're doing the research that we're doing. So today I'm primarily going to be talking about the southern Murray-Darling Basin, and that's the whole of the River Murray and the lower Darling River, and the tributaries of the River Murray, like the Edward Wacall and a few of the Victorian ones. And I'm probably going to be talking about three regions in the River Murray, the lower River Murray, downstream of the Darling River Junction, the mid River Murray between the Darling and about Barmer Forest, and then the upper River Murray upstream of Barmer Forest. So these are some photos of the River Murray, a working river, we often hear it called, and it's a pretty hard working river, I reckon. Big headwater storages, irrigation offtakes, pipes and channels, and the lower 800 kilometres of river, a series of locks and weirs that really change the way the river flows in that region. And if we look at buckets of water, like end of system flow in the Murray, we can see that flow out the Murray mouth is about a third of what it historically was, and probably a bucket of, that doesn't really tell you much about what that means to fish, but it's a lot of water. If we look at this, which is that pretty washed out, I reckon, but really this is the same plot as Ian was showing before. It was essentially, we've got flow on this axis here in white, we've got flow across the South Australian border during the Millennium Drought, and in red, we've got flow that would have naturally occurred, so modelled natural. And what you see, this is in the lower River Murray, that naturally, as Ian said, every year you'd get a big within-channel pulse or an overbank flow. And although we say that the Murray River and rivers in the Murray-Darling Basin are highly variable, this seasonality in the River Murray was highly predictable. What we also see in the lower Murray, as I said, is a series of locks and weirs that change a historically flowing river into a series of weir pools or lakes under what we call entitlement flows. So if you're a riverine fish that's adapted to this natural seasonal variability or this flowing water, you think you might be in a bit of strife. And today I'm going to look at three of these riverine fish that we're probably all familiar with: golden perch, or callop if you come from South Australia, silver perch, and Murray cod. These are just some data that we hear, and we've heard it a few times today, that native fish populations are about 10% of their historical levels. And this is some of the data that this was based on. And I'll just quickly go through this. This was put together by Martin Mallon Cooper, and it's some fishway catches at Euston Fishway in the 1940s and then in the late 80s. And the black bars are catches in the 1940s, 10 to 20 years after the locks and weirs were finished. And the hashed bars are in the late 80s. And you can see for silver perch here, one of the fish I'm going to talk about, that massive decrease in abundance. So that's some of the data that sits behind that. But it's not all bad news. In the last decade, we've seen substantial increases in the amount of environmental water that can be delivered back to the river. And in 2017, in the lower Murray, there was about 1,700 gigalitres that was available in environmental water, and that's worth about $3 billion. So there's a lot of scrutiny on what needs to be done with this water and what can be achieved with this water. And we hear a lot about integrating best available science into the management of that water and also monitoring response. And I suppose just quickly I want to touch on this science and science feeding up into management. we often hear about two things when we're talking about science. We've got monitoring and we've got research, and they're not the same thing. Monitoring is really about investigating patterns. What patterns do we see? You know, what species of fish are there? How many are there? But they don't really tell us anything about why those patterns are occurring. Whereas research is about trying to determine why you're seeing those patterns. And it's the research that gives the managers levers to pull, and then we can monitor the response to that. So coming back to these fish, we've heard a little bit about them already. Golden perch and silver perch. This is where the state-of-the-art graphics come in. I drew them too. You couldn't guess, could you? This is our native fish populations at about 10% of what they were historically. And this is where we want to try and get them. We want to grow our native fish populations to, I reckon that's about 60%. And primarily, we're talking about using water to do this. We know there's other things that are needed, but primarily we're talking about water. But as Jono said earlier, as John Kewen said earlier, if we're talking about populations and population dynamics or growth, there's a few things we've got to consider here. We've got to consider fish being born and surviving. We've got to consider fish dying. We've got to consider fish immigrating and emigrating, so moving into and out of populations. And this gives us our end result. And what we really want to know is how is flow influencing all of those processes. So with regards to golden perch and silver perch, I'll speak about golden perch first. The first thing we might want to do is we want to understand patterns. And I'll look at some data here from the River Murray. And to collect data on patterns, we'll take an electrofishing boat out and we'll take a sample of fish. And really, we're surveying the demographics of the population. And this is length. So this is 128 golden perch collected in the Lower Murray. And this is the range of lengths we get. And what we really want to know with that population is, well, do we have young fish in the population, you know, juvenile fish, sort of middle-aged fish and old fish? Now, you can look at length and say, oh, well, we can tell that from length. But using length is a pretty poor surrogate for age in golden perch. So this is a 450 millimeter long golden perch, and you'd be pretty stoked if you caught a golden perch like that. And you might look at it and say, oh, that's a pretty big fish. It's probably fairly old. Well, I've actually just been looking at some age and length data on the weekend, some recent data, and in the Lower River Murray, a 450 millimeter golden perch could be 7 years old, or it could be 17 years old. So if we're interested in the time that fish was born and the conditions of when it was spawned, what could have happened 7 years ago might be very different from what happened 17 years ago. You could have been in drought or flood. So what we really want to know is the age of the fish. Don't giggle, I reckon I did all right, John. Rod said keep it simple, so I've kept it simple. So what we can do is we can take a subsample of fish, we can sacrifice those fish, we kill them, and we can remove the ear stone or otolith from those fish. Now this is a bit better, this is a real photo of an otolith. This grows within the fish. When the fish is born, the otolith starts growing. It's made of calcium carbonate, so it is like a stone or a rock. And every day that fish grows, it adds a little bit more to its otolith. So if we take a slice through that otolith, we actually see this banding in the otolith. And in really young fish, you can see a daily band. Up to about 100 days old in a golden perch, you can work out how many days that was. But in older fish, you get an annual band, and this is an 11-year-old golden perch. So we can get a good idea of age. So then we can look at our length data, and we can take a subsample of fish and look at the age structure of that population. And that's what we've got on the right-hand side here, fish from 1 year old through to 20 years old. And these are some data that we collected in the Lower River Murray and the Mid River Murray in association with Victoria and New South Wales in 2016. And what you'll notice there is this really dominant group of six-year-old fish. And these fish were spawned in 2009-10. 2009-10 was at the end of the millennium drought. The big flood was in 10-11. So it's amazing how this cohort of fish, this group of fish, dominates those populations 6 years later. Now, there have been a whole lot of people working sort of in the River Murray catchment and the Darling, looking at spawning and recruitment of golden perch. And if we look through the millennium drought, we sort of had this model along the Murray that you get spawning and recruitment of golden perch when you get overbank flows in the lower Murray, or you get a bit of a within-channel flow pulse. But in these years, and this blue flow here is flow across the South Australian border, when you just get entitlement flow delivered, so 3,000 meg a day in winter, 7,000 meg a day in summer, you don't tend to get a cohort of golden perch coming through. So we were a little bit baffled by this 2009-10 spawn cohort, but what you'll also see there is in that year, in January, February, there was a good flow down the Darling River, which is shown here. And at that time, and when we saw these fish coming through, we wondered, well, could have those fish actually come from the Darling River? So it's a bit hard to ask a dead six-year-old golden perch where they came from, and it's probably hard to ask a live one. So what we can do is we can go back to the otolith, because not only can you tell age, but you can potentially tell where fish have come from. So as the otolith is growing, it's incorporating elements from the water that's surrounding the fish. So as it lays down these layers, it actually lays down a signature of the surrounding water. So what we want to try and determine is the water chemistry in different places in the Murray-Darling Basin, or at least the Southern Basin, different? And one of the things we're using for this is strontium isotopes. And the reason why we're interested in these is because the strontium isotopes in water are reflective of the geology of a catchment. And so they're determined by the underlying bedrock in that catchment. So if you have different geology in different catchments, you have different strontium isotope ratios. What we first wanted to know was the Darling strontium isotope ratio different from the Murray? And if you look at this photo here of the junction of the Murray and Darling rivers, you'd think maybe those catchments have got different geology. You know, they are quite distinct. And when we looked at strontium isotope ratios, just simply in the Murray and the Darling, they were vastly different. So we thought, well, we're onto something here, this is good. What we've done in subsequent years is we've had a whole lot of help from researchers and weir keepers collecting water samples from throughout the Southern Murray-Darling Basin to look at differences across the basin in strontium isotope ratios in water and through time. And I'll try and put this pretty simply. There's a couple of places in the Murray and the Darling that have very steady strontium isotope ratios, no variability. And that's the Upper Murray, upstream of Barmer, which sits up here, and the Darling River, which year in, year out, it's the same, it's all the way down here. But the mid-Murray is also different from the Upper Murray, although it's a bit more variable. And the Lower Murray River is highly variable, but it still sits outside of these. And the reason you get that variability in the Lower Murray is because you've got all these different water sources coming in. So I'm going to come back to this sort of plot in a minute. So that's what we call our isoscape in water. That's what our strontium's like. We can go back to our otolith, and we get a laser, and Melbourne Uni have been helping us with this, and they blow out the core of the otolith when that fish was born. And if you measure the strontium isotope ratio there, you can match it to water, potentially, where that fish was born. Also, we can actually take a transect across the otolith from the time the fish was born to the time the fish had died, and look at how strontium varies throughout that fish's life and maybe work out if it's moved between catchments. So this is a bit of a complex plot. I'll step you through it. This is one of those age 6 golden perch, 2009-10 golden perch, that we collected at Swan Reach in the Lower Murray. Zero down here is its core of its otolith. Up here is the edge of its otolith. And these are the years, the distances between the rings on that otolith. If you look down here, this green dashed line is the Darling River strontium isotope ratio. This fish was born in the Darling River, and very early in its life, it probably drifted as a larvae into the Murray River, into the Lower Murray, and spent the rest of its life in the Lower Murray River. And that's probably what it looked like when it drifted in. And then we've looked at these age 6 golden perch from Loxton in South Australia or Toolibuck in New South Wales, and every single one of these fish we've looked at has a Darling River signature early in its life. This fish here, but what's interesting about these fish is that a lot of them spent the first year of their life in the Darling, and then in the 2010-11 floods, migrated downstream, and they either swam downstream into the Lower Murray, which is this fish, or they swam upstream, which is this fish collected at Toolibuck, and you can see this mid-Murray signature where it's been for the rest of its life. One of the things we've been working on just recently is we've taken a sample of golden perch that were collected in the commercial fishery in the Lower Lakes, where there still is a commercial fishery, and we've looked at the same things in those. There's quite a strong cohort of four-year-old golden perch down in the Lower Lakes, and those four-year-old golden perch, which were spawned in a high-flow year after the big floods, some of them come from the Darling River, and some of them are spawned in the Lower River Murray itself. So the Darling River is influencing, in some years, all the way down to the Lower Lakes and all the way upstream, up past Tullybuck as well. I'll just go through this. I'll just go on to silver perch quickly. I won't talk much about population dynamics of silver perch. Zeb Tonkin's going to talk about that tomorrow. I'm going to look at some of this otolith chemistry work. So like golden perch, we had a look at samples of silver perch from the Lower River Murray and the Mid Murray. And these are the age structures once again. And when we looked at these in 2016, six-year-old fish were highly abundant in these regions and formed the largest part of the populations. Again, they were spawned in 2009-10. And straight away, we said to ourselves, well, could they have been spawned in the Darling River as well? These are two fish collected from the Lower Murray. The first one we looked at Loch 3, wasn't spawned in the Darling River. It was spawned in the Mid-Murray River. And just about on its first birthday during the 10-11 floods, it migrated downstream to the Lower Murray. But this silver perch was spawned in the Darling River and came down out of the Darling into the Lower Murray. So silver perch in the Lower Murray in 2009-10 had two sources. When we look at silver perch in the Mid-Murray, what we see is that fish are often spawned in that region. They have this Mid-Murray signature. But then in the 10-11 floods, these fish migrated downstream, spent a few years in the Lower Murray River with this signature, and then as five-year-olds migrated back upstream to the Mid-Murray. So these big movements between regions of the Murray. So as Jono alluded to before, we've got silver perch and golden perch populations in the southern Murray-Darling Basin operating over really large scales, hundreds to thousands of kilometres. And the population structure in any one region might be dependent on spawning there or spawning somewhere else and movement in or emigration from that region. So in just a couple of minutes that I've hopefully got left, I'm just going to touch on Murray cod, which is another species I'm sure we're all interested in. During the floods last year, we were able to get some collections of fish from the Edward Warkal system that died during the Blackwater event and also from the Lower Murray. And we've just been having an initial look at the migration history of those fish using strontium as well. This is two Murray cod from the Edward Warkal, a three-year-old fish on the left-hand side, a 13-year-old fish on the right-hand side. The Edward Warkal has a similar signature to the Upper Murray because it has, its water comes off upstream of Barmer there. And you can see this three-year-old fish or the 13-year-old fish were pretty much spawned in that region and spent the whole of their life in that region, maybe a bit of movement between the Murray and the Edward Warkal. Whereas this is a 42-year-old Murray cod from the Lower Murray that died during the Blackwater. These bounds here are the Lower Murray signature. This fish was born in the Lower Murray and spent its whole life in the Lower Murray. And what we're really finding when we look at the microchemistry of these Murray cod is that most of the fish you look at in those samples have spent their whole lives in those regions, so their populations are operating over sort of tens to hundreds of kilometres. But we do know we get movement between those regions, but it doesn't appear to be a significant structure of the populations. So just putting this all together, when we're looking at trying to rehabilitate riverine fish populations and grow native fish populations, we've got to consider the scales of life history of these fish and their populations. You can't just water an icon site and hope to restore golden perch at that site. You've got to be looking at the scales this is happening over. But for Murray cod, there are opportunities potentially to restore habitats at that tens to hundreds of kilometres. Restoring connectivity, we've heard it a lot today. We've heard about fishways. Downstream movement is also really important. And when we've got weir pools and these larvae and eggs can't drift, you're impeding downstream connectivity. So we've really got to look at conserving and restoring flowing water habitats, and particularly in the Lower River Murray, reintroducing the river to the River Murray. We've got to deliver flows in an integrated cross-jurisdictional manner. If we're going to work across the scale of golden perch and silver perch, we've heard a little bit about the river's heartbeat. I'm not going to speak much more about that. And then finally, I think hopefully this shows that both monitoring patterns and research to understand processes is going to be integral to growing native fish populations. Thank you. No time for questions.